Okay, on this video I'm going to do a comparison between the new iPad Air and the iPad Pros. Now, I'm a great believer in only buying the amount of iPad that you actually need. There's no point spending an absolute fortune on the biggest iPad with the greatest spec if you're not going to utilize and make use of all that power. So the question is the new iPad Air enough of an iPad to rival the iPad Pros for a lot of people? So just a quick unboxing of the iPad Air. It's the usual plastic wrapped, but a really nice, pristine cardboard box, as you come to expect from Apple. Inside the box, we have the iPad presented front and center. We can lift it up. Got a nice plastic sleeve that we can peel off. And the iPad is just contained within that plastic sleeve. I've got the sky blue version. Inside the box, we have the power brick, a USB-C cable, and the power brick is actually 20 watts, which is an upgrade from the iPad Pros, which are only 18. So this will charge a little bit faster. Now, one of the biggest changes for this version of the iPad Air is obviously its shape and dimensions and everything else, the way it looks, really. So we have the flat edges, we have the rounded corners, and we have actually the exact same footprint as the iPad Pro, the 11-inch iPad Pro. However, we have a slightly smaller diagonal on the screen. This is 10.9 compared to 11. You can see there is a slightly wider bezel on the iPad Air compared to the iPad Pro. Now, it's not going to be a deal breaker for most people, but still, the difference does exist. Now, I don't know why that would be the case. Perhaps it's just more expensive to actually try and reduce the size of the bezel, considering the fact that we also have a depth camera here for Face ID, and this doesn't. It's surprising that it's actually narrower on the iPad Pro, but there you go. Now, the best iPad to compare it to would be the 11-inch one, seeing as it contains or is contained within the same footprint. So it has the same length, the same width, but we have a slightly wider or deeper body to it. This is 6.1 millimeters compared to the 5.9 on the iPad Pro. Again, just like the bezel that goes around it, I can't imagine it's much of a deal breaker for anyone, but there is a slight difference. Although we have a four speaker appearance on the iPad Air, so we have grills there and there, there is actually only two speakers within the iPad Air. So you get stereo, but there is only two speakers compared to four speakers on all the iPad Pros. Another major difference is that we have Touch ID on the iPad Air compared to Face ID on the iPad Pro. Now, I've never really been a big fan of Face ID. It's acceptable on the iPhone. It makes sense. You're holding it the correct way and yeah, it's right in front of your face. I've noticed on the iPad Pro, however, because the camera, the Face ID camera, doesn't exactly announce itself, you might have the iPad the wrong way around or the opposite way around and it tells you have to look at a different camera. You're not looking at the right point. I find it quite annoying at certain times. So I think that the Touch ID for the iPad Air, it's going to be more consistent. You're going to see visually exactly where the button is and you're going to use it for switching on the iPad anyway, and therefore it's going to get you logged in much faster, I would say. So probably the best thing I personally feel about the iPad Air this time is that it is compatible with the Apple Pencil too. Now, when you're actually using the Apple Pencil within an app, then you're not going to experience much of a difference. But that extra flexibility or extra convenience, rather, of having it snapped straight onto the side of the iPad, charge and pair from there, means that it's always charged. So I think this is a great improvement for the latest version of the iPad Air, and it sets it apart from the lower end iPad as well. Now, it's compatible with the Magic Keyboard, which is compatible, you know, with both the iPad Pros, all the iPad Pros, and now the iPad Air as well. Another major difference is the colours that this comes in. Now, you might not be able to pick it up on screen, but this isn't silver or space grey. This is the sky blue colour. Now, it's not a very strong blue colour, but yeah, it's a nice change, perhaps, from the usual colours that you can get. So you compare it, perhaps, with the silver, you can see the sky blue next to it. It also comes in a really nice green colour, rose gold, and the silver and space grey. Now, in terms of the screens here, it again is another area of quite big difference. So although the iPad Pros and the iPad Air both have liquid retina displays, they have the same anti-reflective coating, they have the same wide colour gamut. One of the areas that is different is the refresh rate. So that's the amount of frames per second, basically. So what you'll notice, well, you won't notice on camera because the actual video that I'm recording is set at 30 frames per second. So you're not going to be able to detect it on camera, but it is something that you will notice in person. So the iPad Pros refresh at a rate of 120 frames per second, whereas the iPad Air refreshes at 60 frames per second. Now, it's not going to make a massive difference to your experience of using it, but there is definitely just a higher level of quality from having things smoothly scroll between screens, for example. Again, it's not necessary, but yes, it is better on the iPad Pro. So apart from not having the ProMotion, it is also not quite as bright. It is 500 nits of brightness compared to the 600 nits of brightness on the iPad Pro. Now, in reality, it's not going to make a huge amount of difference, but yeah, the iPad Pro in outdoor environments, for example, is going to be a little bit more visible. Now, the iPad Air has a slightly different screen ratio and size to the 11-inch iPad Pro, but they've tweaked and modified it so that across the whole range there's going to be a 264 pixels per inch pixel density. So in terms of the way that the screen appears, there's going to be no difference between the iPad Pros and the iPad Air either. So yeah, they all have True Tone, they all have anti-reflective coating, they all have a wide color gamut. The only real difference is the slight brightness difference and the lack of ProMotion on the iPad Air. Again, things that you may not really care that much about, but they are differences nevertheless. Now, flipping it over, you'll notice on the iPad Air we have one camera. Now, it's a 12 megapixel rear camera, and in the front we have a 7 megapixel FaceTime HD camera. So they're not bad cameras by any means, they're really quite good, but compared to the iPad Pros, now as I was saying earlier in the video, I don't see any point in splashing out the money on the latest iPad unless you're going to actually make use of it. So I don't have the latest iPad Pro. This is the 2018 version, which is pretty much identical to the 2020 version, except for substantial change in the actual camera. So on the newest iPad Pros, we do have a triple camera system. The 2020 version, there's a 12 megapixel main camera, a 10 megapixel ultra wide camera, and a 2x telephoto zoom as well as the standard 7 megapixel FaceTime HD front camera. And it has a LiDAR sensor as well, which is good for augmented reality apps and things like that. But in all honesty, if you're just using an iPad like this for creative projects, whether it's Procreate or another creative app, features like the camera are probably not going to make much of a difference to you. Now, if photography is a really big thing for you and you don't have a decent camera on your phone, then maybe you're going to be concerned about using the iPad as your main camera. So I don't feel that's a reason to get a Pro over an iPad Air. But in terms of the hardware and performance now, the iPad Air has an A14 processor. It's the newest one and it's the one that's in the newest iPhone 12s as well. It's got the new thing called a 5-nanometer process, which apparently means it's got lots of tiny transistors all over it, compared to the A12Z Bionic processor in the 2020 iPad Pro. So it sounds like it's jumped forward from an A12 to an A14. It sounds really impressive to have jumped forward two processors. However, it's not the full story, because on the inside of the iPad Air, we have a 6-core CPU and a 4-core GPU, whereas on the iPad Pro, we have an 8-core CPU and an 8-core GPU. So in terms of the GPU on the iPad Pros, it's double the amount of graphics performance than the iPad Air. Now, partly that's explained by the fact that it needs that for the higher refresh rates, but it also means it's going to handle apps and programs better as well. Now, in terms of how it handles apps and the amount of information that it can process at once, obviously we need to think about RAM as well. Now, Apple rarely publishes RAM information about their devices, but I can tell you that this latest version of the iPad Air has 4 gigabytes of RAM compared to the previous Air, which only had 3. Now, the latest version of the iPad Pros do have 6 gigabytes of RAM, and that's across all of the iPad Pros of the later version. Having said that, now this version that I've been using for the last couple of years is the version that does have 4 gigabytes of RAM. There were options to have 6 gigabytes of RAM in the 1 terabyte version of the 2018 iPad Pro, but the standard amount of RAM was in fact 4. Now, I can use loads of layers in an app like Procreate, so I sincerely don't think you should worry about it not having enough RAM. It's got tons of RAM, tons of processing power within the processor. I honestly don't think that that's a reason for the vast majority of people to go for a Pro over the iPad Air. I think both of these types of iPads, whether it's the 2018 version, the 2020 version of the iPad Pro, or the latest iPad Air, I think all of them had fantastic processors and chips. What might be an issue, perhaps, is the amount of storage that you can get these models in. So, for example, the iPad Air comes in 2 storage sizes. It's got the 64 and the 256 gigabyte versions. So for the 64 gigabyte version, it starts at $599 and £579. And for the greater storage option of 256, it goes up by $150 to $749. And in pounds, it goes from £579 up to £729. Now, it's a massive jump. Admittedly, if you really need that extra storage, I mean, it is quite a big difference between 64 and 256. If you really need that extra storage, I guess it's worth spending that extra £150 on, but it's still a big jump. So the latest iPad Pro start at 128GB and go all the way up to 1TB. So the starting price, the cheapest iPad Pro that you can get for an 11-inch version is $799. Now compare that to the cheapest version of the iPad Air, and that's $200 difference. And there's also £190 difference. So again, we're looking around the £200, $200 difference between the cheaper 11-inch iPad Pro and the cheaper 11-inch or 10.9-inch iPad Air. So they're very similar in lots of ways, but it's $200 difference. And if you're wanting to get a 12.9-inch version, well then the cheapest version of that, which is the 128GB version, is $999. Again, we're looking at a $400 difference. So in conclusion, you can get the cheapest iPad Air 4 for $599. Now bear in mind, that doesn't come with the Apple Pencil, so you'll have to spend like another $130 for the Apple Pencil. It's going to be expensive enough. I wouldn't personally advise anyone to add another $200 to that price tag just so you can get the 11-inch iPad Pro. Now it's another matter if you must have the larger iPad Pro, in which case you're going to have to spend another $400 to get that from the basic price of the iPad Air. Now, if storage differences are really good and important to you, then you have to consider how much storage you can get away with. It comes with 64GB, which is not a huge amount, but it's plenty big enough to save all your paintings, all your art, and probably all your photographs and other things in addition to that as well. So choose carefully. I think this is more than good enough for the vast majority of aspiring artists. And with all the latest, greatest chips inside it and compatibility with the Magic Keyboard, the Apple Pencil, and other devices that will connect to the USB-C, it's going to last you for years as well. I'm going to be doing a tutorial on the iPad Air just to put it through the test of how it actually behaves when I'm actually doing one of my paintings, one of my tutorials on it. So make sure to subscribe to my channel. Do press the bell notification button though, because YouTube's a bit strange. It doesn't always let you know. Check the links down in the description of this video for all other related things, and I shall catch you back here soon. See you later.